So we are really excited today to have Drs. Peter Moyle and Jason Baumsteiger talking about extinction in fishes and preparing for extinction of Delta smelt. Sorry. This talk is one of a series previewing the upcoming State of Bay Delta Science 2016. The State of Bay Delta Science 2016 is a collection of papers that summarizes the scientific understanding of the Sacramento-San Joaquin Delta. It emphasizes scientific progress made since the previous State of Bay Delta Science edition published in 2008. The first batch, including Peter Moyle's chapter on Delta Smelt, is available online in the San Francisco Estuary and Watershed Sciences Journal. I really recommend checking out Peter's paper. It's really great. And it is the first paper I've ever seen that starts with a haiku, which is quite interesting. I'll read it to you guys in case you can't read it in the back. "Hey there, Delta Smelt. If you hang on for a while, you will fool us all." Very optimistic. So speaking of this entry in the State of Bay Delta Science, we have a summary, a two-page summary here, and on your way out, please grab one. It covers the key points of this article. So our first speaker today is Dr. Jason Baumsteiger. He is a postdoctoral research fellow with the Watershed Sciences Center at UC Davis. He is a former fisheries geneticist with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Services and was one of the first to get his Ph.D. at UC Merced. His expertise, what is your mascot? Go?
Bobcat.
Go Fairy Shrimp.
We tried.
His expertise is applying genetic and genomic tools to different fisheries-related questions, from population dynamics to novel species identification. He is currently working on the genomics of California roach, hitch, and sculpin, and just finished working with Dr. Mike Miller, who is also at UC Davis, on devil's hole pupfish. Our second speaker is Dr. Peter Moyle, who has been working on the ecology and conservation of California's freshwater and estuarine fishes since 1969. He wrote books including The Inland Fishes in California in 2002, Fish, An Enthusiast's Guide in 1993, and more recently, in 2014, he wrote Sisson Marsh, Ecological History and Possible Futures. He has co-authored numerous papers on ecology, status and trends of California's native and alien fishes, including Delta smelt, and ongoing research focuses on climate change, reconciliation ecology, salmonid conservation, and fishes of the San Francisco estuary. He is Distinguished Professor Emeritus in the Department of Wildlife, Fish, and Conservation Biology and Associate Director of the Center for Watershed Sciences, UC Davis. So now we will start our talk. Let's please welcome Dr. Jason Baumsteiger.
Good afternoon, everybody. I have the inevitable task of coming before Peter talks, so I'll go as quickly as possible. Kind of like the opening band, right? Yeah, they're good, but bring on the headliner. But it is important, actually, what I have to say, or else Peter's going to talk about a bunch of stuff, and it's going to look like a bunch of really cool fish pictures, but it may not make a lot of sense contextually, so try and stay with me. I have words in my talk. Sorry. All right, so we're going to assess extinction in freshwater fishes, which, surprisingly, isn't very well known. So we'll start out with mine. We'll lead on to Peter's, where he's going to give you specific examples, and then Peter and I are really interested in your feedback on what we're going to present here today. We want to see, feel, hear, hopefully politely, what you think of our ideas, because we're hoping to write this up, because literally right now, as we're going to introduce to you, there is no assessment of extinction in fishes, or actually in most species, as it turns out, and we'll kind of get to that here in a minute. So we'll start out with what I'm going to propose for you. This works. So many of you probably know that extinction is a big problem and that we are in the current sixth mass extinction event, right? You might argue against that, but the science is basically there. So what are we going to do about it? Are we going to just continue to wave to these species as they go by, or are we going to step up and try and learn more about them? So most people, when they talk about extinction, use the IUCN, right? The classic least concern, near threatened, endangered, critically endangered, and so on and so forth. As you might notice, as you can see from the graph up there, freshwater fishes aren't exactly doing all that well. Plants obviously doing worse. But there's a number of species that are obviously at risk of extinction, but almost all of them are going to fall into the endangered or critically endangered categories, as shown at the bottom. But when it comes to actual extinction, there's only really two categories, extinction in the wild and extinct, and in which case their proposal is essentially you wait 50 years, and basically you haven't seen them, and then you call them extinct, which we think is a little bit vague and perhaps requires a little more definition. The quote is, there's no reasonable doubt that the last individual has died. So what's reasonable doubt? Well, if anybody watches any court shows, reasonable doubt gets a little iffy. So we're going to try and get into that a little bit better. But before I do that, I would like to clarify something very quickly. So the laws, when it comes to extinction or defining extinction, basically say a group of organisms must be defined as a distinct entity. And as most of you know, defining a distinct entity also a bit iffy. So it might be a species, it might be a subspecies, it might be a DPS, an ESU, or an MU. All of these things could technically go extinct, which makes it even more difficult to actually assess extinction. But for the sake of simplicity, we're just going to call any of these groups as a lineage. So rather than call something a species, subspecies, whatever, we're just going to call them a lineage, okay? So insert any one of these, if that's interesting to you, into our talk today. So, in your mind, think about it right now, is extinction essentially presence absence? They were here one day, they're gone the next. Is that how you see extinction? Many of you, maybe the answer is yes. But let me ask you, what if a single individual still exists? Is that lineage extinct? What if it's completely reliant on humans? Meaning it can't exist on its own. It's completely reliant on us. Is it extinct? I don't know. What if it's absent from its native range? There's literally no more out in their native range. Are they extinct? What if it has no habitat at all? What if it lived in a spring and that spring is gone? You've got it over here in some pool. Is that extinct? Is it still the same species?
Sorry.
Lineage. See, even I have that problem. Okay, what if it's been genetically modified? Uh-oh. Aren't we supposed to label that? Right? Or, as some people have been proposing, what if you hybridize it with something else? To save this lineage, what if you hybridize it with its next closest relative? Has that actual lineage gone extinct? So it turns out maybe presence-absence isn't the easiest thing to define. Plus, what happens when something gets really, really small, when you have just a few number of individuals? It's very cryptic. For example, in fishes, it's very hard to find them sometimes. So do you just call it like, oh, I can't see them, I've been out 20 times. Is that enough? Are they extinct? When do we stop? How far do we go? This is what we're going to try and get into. So Peter and I believe that extinction is more of a process that we need to kind of work ourselves through. And we're going to hopefully set out some guidelines to get through that particular process. But before we can even get to that, we have to kind of get into some, I don't know, difficult areas to kind of discuss. So obviously humans impact virtually every aspect of the planet, right? There's virtually no species, lineage, anything that can exist that doesn't have some impact by us on it in some way or another. So we can't really just discount all of those and say, well, that's a natural system. There's always going to have these indirect effects, right? But the key thing that we want to think about, when you talk about indirect effects, natural selection is still acting on the lineage, okay? That's how we're kind of going to try and differentiate these two. Because a natural alternative, for example, you can build a dam, and that is still an indirect effect. Because you could have a landslide, and it could create a dam, right? So there are these kinds of things that exist in nature. It's not just us. So that's kind of an indirect effect. And these indirect effects apply to the whole group, right? So every fish in a particular habitat is affected by a dam, not just one particular species or lineage, right? Whereas direct effects, once you start talking about direct effects, now we're lineage specific. We're acting specifically on that lineage that we're interested in. And only humans really cause those kinds of changes, right? And usually, in this case, artificial selection is the primary driver. So differentiating these two, indirect and direct, we believe is where assessing extinction really kind of, it gets the crux, gets the real key to being able to define these things. So what I'm showing you here, because a lot of people sometimes struggle with the differences between natural selection and artificial selection, I took the four primary tenets of natural selection, and I'm showing you here just very quickly what you expect to find when you have natural selection versus what you expect to find when you have artificial selection, okay? So just briefly, because obviously we don't want to sit here and read them, right? When you look at artificial selection, you're talking about specific traits. You're talking about success and fecundity are being maximized. You're not allowing things to just vary. You're specifically targeting things. You're doing things that are, in a way, unnatural. That's why it's artificial selection, right? You're artificially mating. You're genetically modifying. You're doing a lot of things that would never happen in a natural system, right? You're eliminating things like prezygotic barriers, predation, biological interactions, parasitism, right? You're giving them antibiotics, let's say if they're in a hatchery. You're doing a lot of things that they would never exist otherwise. So would that make them extinct? Well, let's kind of talk about that. So I like this example. This is the one I've been using. So obviously pugs are descendants of wolves, yes? Through artificial breeding over a number of years, right, we have domesticated and created a pug. Are these the same? So if I was to say, like, I believe we need to put the pugs back into Montana because that's what's missing. Shouldn't we do that? Aren't they the same? Well, even if you want to go a step further, aren't their genomes essentially the same? There's very, very, very few actual genetic differences between pugs and wolves, right? But are they the same thing? Uh-oh, now it's more complex, huh? I don't know. How long? Would you give them a week? We argue 2 weeks, maybe? I don't know. All right. So what we propose is the standard system right now, the endangered species, critically endangered, threatened, we believe that any lineage that falls in those categories is still in its natural environment under natural selective pressures. Which case, no matter how many there are in that particular area, whether you, however you want to count your lineage, 5, 10, 100, 1,000, whatever you feel that population or lineage needs to be, those are still indirect effects, and those fall into that category and system. But if you start applying lineage-specific effects, where you're essentially applying artificial selection onto a lineage, we believe that this has reached a level of extinction because it's no longer the same natural organism in its natural environment, right? Is that to say that we don't protect it or anything like that? We're not saying that at all. It still gets its protection because something is better than nothing, right? 80% is still better than zero. So, but we still need to recognize that trying to trot out pugs and say that they are wolves is not the same thing. And a lot of times we're getting caught doing that. So we have something that essentially, what made a wolf is not encapsulated in a pug, no matter how much we try. Right? So, but that still means that it's better to start with that because maybe pugs, I don't know, you give them 100 years, do they look more like wolves? Do you think evolution would act like that? But isn't that essentially what we're doing with a lot of our fish species? So, uh-oh, more complicated. All right. So what we're going to propose is essentially 6 novel categories and a series of guidelines to try and work our way through this idea. So our primary goal is just to provide an easy kind of step-by-step process to assess extinction. Secondarily, we want to highlight the fact that applying indirect effects and trying to alleviate indirect effects should happen first before we ever consider applying direct effects. We should try very, very hard to work through all the things that are causing extinction that are indirect before we start applying direct. So that we, again, do what everybody wants to do, which is avoid extinction. All right? That's fine. We can go on. So the first category, this one is a little bit controversial. Once something becomes conservation reliant, meaning it's basically dependent on us for its existence, we believe it's reached the first category, which we're calling mitigated extinction. So essentially, it was going to drop out, that lineage, and we went in and saved it, right? But in order to do so, we had to apply artificial selection and maybe have to continue to apply it, in which case we mitigated on its behalf, right? Otherwise, it doesn't exist at all. So we've reached our first category, right? So this also includes if we have to intentionally hybridize or genetically modify something, right? It's not the same natural lineage in its natural environment under natural selective pressures. Second one is regional extinction. This is basically more of a category just for simplicity of bookkeeping. So, for example, bull trout used to extend into California. They no longer do so, right? So they're regionally extinct. Okay, so you would say they're regionally extinct here in California. Are bull trout extinct in North America? No. So that's a simple process. Native range extinction, right? It's no longer present in its native range, of which we have a number of species, which Peter will present to you, right? Wild extinction, it's no longer in the wild. So, for example, black rhinos are only found in zoos now, right? We lost the last one, I believe, just recently here. So there are none in the wild at all. So is that species, in that case the black rhino, extinct? There's no native organisms in their native range doing anything that they're supposed to. They're hand-fed in a zoo. They're bred specifically. Now, would they choose the partners that they're bred with? No. So we're eliminating all of those facts. Now we come to this category, which is visual extinction. All right, so now we don't see any anywhere, right? Do we just call them extinct? Well, no, we don't think that that's really what you need to do. You need to have a waiting period. And we're going to discuss that waiting period here in a second on how long we think you should wait. And then finally, if everything has been tried and everything's been done and they've completely disappeared and we haven't seen them after a certain amount of time, then they become globally extinct. So what we hope is these simple categories with these little indignations make it very easy for you to just categorize which one and which level they have reached in these particular categories. Visual extinction is interesting because applying years doesn't really apply because there's a difference between how long a sturgeon lives versus how long a pupfish lives. So 50 years in pupfish years is a long time. Sturgeon, you might even get through one generation, maybe not. So we propose to do it by generation time. So if you wait 0 to 5 generations, right, if you have an organism which has a 0 to 5 year generation time, you would wait approximately 10 generations. If it has greater than 5 year generation time, then you would wait 5 generations, right? And Peter will just show you all of these here in a second here, right? So this allows for a conservative wait time, but not such an exhaustive time as you're waiting 50, 100 years or something like that, which doesn't really allow for good management practice in our opinion. So, unfortunately, I can't go through all of these steps. This is basically our little diagram of how you would work yourself through as to which level your lineage has reached in terms of its extinction category. So you can start at the top. You just basically are going to ask yourself a series of questions and just work through simple flow diagram. And you get to two areas. And there's a diversion that I want you to see right there at the beginning of extinction, which is whether or not you're going to apply direct effects or continue to apply indirect effects. If you're going to apply indirect effects, which means you're not going to go in and specifically alter, artificially select, on that lineage, then you stay in the left-hand category. It's just really low numbers, right? They're dropping out. But if you start applying things and they still continue to drop out, then you would move, in this case, category on the right. Finally, you see a series of checkpoints that I'm showing you here. We believe there should be an assessment committee of a group of biologists who should get together and assess these things yearly and be able to categorize as the different lineages work themselves through these various categories that we proposed here. So I'm just going to give you very, very briefly each of the checkpoints, right? So the committee would make recommendations at the very beginning, right? What's the underlying cause of extinction? Is it in decline? Is there ways to alleviate indirect effects? So on and so forth. Second checkpoint, which is right before you get to what we're calling our extinction process, right? Are you going to go ahead and apply direct effects, right? Are there funds in place to make something conservation reliant? Because once it becomes conservation reliant, you're paying for it for all of existence. It's completely dependent on you forever, right? That's a big commitment. So you should probably have something in mind if you're going to go down that particular road, right? You also can assess your extinction category. Finally, you get to checkpoint 3, which is our reevaluation each year. You're going to see if you've been able to move up or down or how management has been able to assess over various amounts of time. You might need to step up your monitoring programs, intensify sampling efforts, and so on. But if you've come all the way down to that point and you've passed all native, regional, wild, and so on, right, you might be time to set your waiting period. So how long, so basically you've reached visual extinction, right? And finally, after you've collected everything, you've weighed the amount of time in terms of generations or whatever, you would get to global extinction. So it's a simplified process, right? Obviously, there's way much more that goes into this. We just wanted to give a simple way to assess extinction. So what's the conservation relevance of all this, right? Lineage-specific efforts that we do, costly, they're often permanent, and they alter the evolutionary trajectory of the organism that we're interested in. Is that really the plan, right? Obviously, in certain situations, yes, we have to do that, absolutely, right? But I think we need to recognize those from ones where we can still put a natural organism in its natural habitat under natural selective pressures. If we can maintain that, then we really actually have saved the organism we're interested in. right? So what we're saying essentially is focus on the indirect effects first. Alleviate the indirect effects, right? Because that's a one-time effort that's not based on a single lineage, but protecting multiple lineages. For those of you who are familiar with the Endangered Species Act, right, every single lineage is protected and has to be, everything has to be done for every single lineage individually once you reach that category. So if you have a system that's in big trouble, instead of saving the system, you have to then fund every single lineage that's becoming extinct independently. That can get really costly. All right? So our guidelines, again, are to bring to light this problem of artificial selection and how it changes things. Right? But, again, it may be absolutely necessary to avoid extinction because we're talking about the end of things. Right? So we're not trying to condemn direct efforts. We're just trying to minimize them, right, as a last-ditch effort. And in order to do that, we're going to give you a whole bunch of examples.
Thanks, Jason. Actually, Jason's a pretty hard act to follow. Lots of information there. I'm going to try to go through, hopefully fairly quickly, showing how this, what he talked about, applies to California fish. And, of course, this is extinction in California fishes, we have experience with extinction, unfortunately, in California. And we are at the stage where we're seeing a high percentage of our fishes with a trajectory towards extinction. You can believe me or not on these things, but the fact is that we have 30 species of fish that are currently listed by the state and federal ESAs. So it's not just me imagining that there are large numbers of fish out there that are not doing very well. So what is extinction? Again, Jason went through these categories, and I want to go through these one at a time and talk about in relation to California fish. Obviously, mitigated extinction is this conservation-reliant species that will go extinct without human help. Obviously, the classic example in California is winter-run Chinook salmon. They're all found in habitat that's just below Shasta Dam, which is not their natural habitat. They're totally reliant on squatting gravels we provide. They're reliant on the flows that come from the dams. And during really severe times like we had the last few years with the mismanagement of the water and so forth, they're totally reliant on a hatchery as well. So that's a classic example of a species that would not exist without continuous human input. And most of the conservation proposals for this continue that process. Then we have the regional extinction. These are species that are still extant but are extirpated from part of their range, as Jason mentioned. This is the second to last bull trout caught in California. The last one was caught by one of my graduate students and returned to the water. I like these pictures. These are also from 1975. Efforts from a fisherman that we discovered. But with 1975 is the last date anywhere caught from the McLeod River. And that's obviously a good example of regional extinction. But it took a long time for us to figure out that they really were gone. These are examples of Colorado river fish, the bony tail and the upper one, the lower one's the Sacramento, the Colorado pike minnow. These are both gone from the Colorado River in California. They're still barely hanging on in the upper parts of the Colorado River Basin, the Yampa River, and places like that. But they're extirpated from California, so we no longer have them as part of the California fish fauna. Now, here's an example of a species that's extinct in its native range. The Sacramento perch is actually really a neat fish. It's a great game fish. But you can go to Crowley Lake and catch them in large numbers. But they're absent from their native range, which is the Central Valley in California, except in ponds where I and others have planted them. And those populations are very ephemeral. So this is a species which you can regard them as being of being essentially secure because they're outside the native range, but in fact these populations outside their native range are not protected and they're winking out one at a time. Now, extinct in the wild is a species that's entirely maintained by captive populations. This is obviously an extreme example of conservation reliance. And the sort of an interesting example of this is the Mojave tui chub, which is gone from the Mojave River, but it's present only in a bunch of ponds, which is very happy. When the dietary study was done a few years ago, its main high component of its diet was breadcrumbs. Like perhaps gives you some idea of how conservation reliant they are. But extinct in the wild is a very real category. Now, the visually extinct species, or you know, as I say, apparently extinct, we don't really know for sure. We're still looking for them. I can't find any good examples in California. Maybe that's a good thing. The Delta smelt may be approaching that category, though. But you're looking for them, and you can't find them. And as Jason mentioned, the IUCN comment is a species is extinct when there's no reasonable doubt the last individual has died. And that just leaves you with the problem of defining reasonable doubt. And some other species in California that are no longer with us, there's a Clear Lake spittail. The last ones were caught in the early 1970s. Used to be hugely abundant in the lake. That's the large fish in this picture. We hardly have any specimens of it because it was not described until after it was extinct. Here's a Clear Lake spittail. Very different from the Sacramento spittail. The thick-tailed chub, last ones were caught in the 1950s. Still people who are around who remember that catching in Steamboat Slough in the Delta. Again, when you look on Indian middens, these are one of the most abundant fish in California, in central California. They are a very important food for the Indians. They now exist as about 100 specimens in jars. Whoops, sorry. So we have the Tacopa pupfish as another example. This is a species which was present in two springs, the Tacopa hot springs. It disappeared in the 1970s after the Tacopa, the springs in which it occurred. It was described as a distinct subspecies, a distinct lineage by our categories. When Tacopa springs were turned into a bathhouse, there obviously was no habitat left for the fish. This is another example of the kind of problems we face here in California. This is a high rock sphinx tui chub, which disappeared in 1989 thanks to the introduction of tilapia into the spring. There's an attempt to farm tilapia, the warm water spring in the middle of Lassen County. We don't even know if this is a good lineage or not. I'm assuming it is because it was up in the middle of nowhere, a long distance from other tui chub populations, but it disappeared before we had a chance to really look at it. And there are only just a handful of specimens that exist. So that's a genuine loss that, unfortunately, we just don't know enough about even to say whether we should call it a species. So how should extinction be determined? And this is the proposal that we have for California. Let me go through these measures one at a time. So Jason talked a little bit about them so we can see what some of our ideas are. How do you determine if a species is extinct? Right now, you know, there aren't that many that are really in that position where they're likely to disappear in the next few years. But we're facing, with the rapidity with which the climate change and sea level is rising, this could be a very real problem in the future. First off, recovery measures have to fail, both ordinary and extraordinary. And for example, I think we're at a point right now where it should be experimenting with these captive populations of smelt that we have. This is before the smelt disappears in the wild, assuming it does. We have this captive population that could be used for outplanting, to experimental outplanting. In places, like this is a photograph of our pens for raising salmon in the Yolo Bypass. I can certainly imagine having smelt reared in those pens for a while. Especially since we discovered in recent years that the toe drain in the bypass and some of the permanent fresh waters in the North Delta actually support year-round populations of smelt. So here's an opportunity. We should be experimenting with these fish while we still have the chance. So this is an example of kind of extraordinary measures that we need to be taking. And you have to determine their absence from routine surveys. You know, the smelt is the most surveyed fish we have practically, although most of the surveys were set up for striped bass. It's always good to remind people of that considering all the bad press striped bass are getting these days. But the fact is that this is a smelt that is now just about disappearing. It's at the levels of detectability right now. You know, the latest surveys for the juvenile fish, you know, had indices of 0.0. But then the next step in all this is to conduct all these intensive surveys in likely and unlikely places. We're already doing that to a certain extent with Delta smelt. I would regard the spring Kodiak trawl survey, for example, is a very focused survey on Delta smelt that's very effective at finding them. And even they're catching very few in that trawl these days. But maybe we should be looking in places like San Luis Reservoir and trying to see if there are other places where these smelt might exist or could exist. But anyway, go back, try to look every place, turn over every stone that you can to really try to figure out if they're still around. Then if you don't find any under those circumstances, you go back to your routine surveys for a fixed number of years. And again, this is based on generation time. As Jason talked about, in the case of Delta smelt, we would say you would look for them for another 10 to 20 years before you declare them extinct. But you have to go back to the routine surveys because they would tell you whether or not they're present. The final steps are these six steps here, which is you put together a group that will determine the likelihood the species is still extant or extinct. And you present the findings to a multi-agency committee of all the diverse people who might be interested in this. Then the committee would make a recommendation to the director of the Department of Fish and Wildlife or the Fish and Game Commission. And then you want the highest politician in California to declare it extinct. You want somebody to take responsibility for this, and that's why we say the announcement should be made by the governor. Or if it's a federal case, by the president, no less. And keep in mind, we're facing the climate change as an increasing probability. When you add climate change as a factor in predicting the likely extinction of the species in California, you get up to 82% by the turn of the century. So in summary then, what Jason and I have been talking about is that extinction is likely to become common in the future. Certainly there are trends in all kinds of organisms that indicate this. It comes in many flavors. It's not easy to define exactly what we mean by extinction. We need to make sure we do know what we mean by extinction. Legal means do exist to delist extinct species. We haven't talked about that, but we need good legal means to do that. The present mechanisms are not very good. And formal processes then are also needed for determination. So at this stage, I think I'd like to open up to discussion, and perhaps we could talk about some of these issues that we've raised here. Do we really need a formal process for extinction, or can we just sort of do what we're doing now and let things keep going, and then when we think the species is extinct, you wait till I do another edition of my book and of Inland Fishes of California, and I say, this species is extinct, everybody nods their head and says, oh, yeah. Or do we need some other process for that? Is the species extinct if artificial selection dominates over natural selection? That's a very difficult question, and it's one that really needs discussion. And then finally, how will we know if the Delta smelt is extinct? How many are there out there right now? The estimate currently is around 13,000. We can hardly even detect them. So how will we know when they're extinct? So these are all great questions for discussion. I hope you have lots of opinions and comments. Okay.
Thank you, everyone.
Lots of time. Andy.
Hello. I guess I have an opinion about Jason's talk. I think that the example of the pugs and the wolves, it's a good example conceptually. I think it's a little misleading. I mean, especially if it's like, in regards to the smelt. And I mean, obviously, I'm involved in the genetic management of the Delta smelt. And yes, artificial selection is undoubtedly a problem, and we don't want to be reliant on a hatchery for the Delta smelt to survive. However, that said, we are bringing wild fish into the population every single year. And so doing the best that we can under the circumstances with the limitations to maintain a population that we hope can be reintroduced into the Delta and survive. So that's my comment.
That's probably what happens when you can no longer collect enough from the wild.
Absolutely,
To maintain those populations, it's already happening. we're almost at the point where Delta smelt are becoming a pretty much a domesticated fish in the sense that they're entirely dependent on culture. It's absolutely one of the best and most sophisticated culture operations that's ever been done for a fish. So it's pretty remarkable. But you still have that problem. Anytime you keep an animal in captivity for any kind of a length of time, it's undergoing artificial selection, and you almost can't help it.
You cannot.
Yeah, so that's why we need to be experimenting now, which the Fish and Wildlife Service is reluctant to do so. Maybe somebody can express it differently. We need to be experimenting now with those fish, trying to see how can you reintroduce them into the wild if it's truly a backup population, or is it just going to be a fish we'll have in aquaria for people to look at and say, here's an extinct species? But we need to experiment with them. That's
totally agree on that count. Yeah.
What's your feeling on chinooks and silvers and steelheads in a worse situation for extinction?
Can you please repeat that question for the people that are watching online?
Yeah. Between chinook and silvers and steelhead, what's your idea on the extension of each category? Which inch?
I can start. One of the things that's important that we think that, again, extinction is a process, and what we want is simple recognition that we've had to start applying artificial selection to these particular lineages, not to say that they're not still a coho or a chinook or something like that, only that we start to recognize that they're very different than, say, something where we haven't had to apply those effects to them, and so we still have it out in its natural habitat doing its natural thing. Those systems are still everything that encompasses that fish as best as can be there, versus we've had to start making these changes, right? Not to prevent making the changes. We're still all for you got to do what you got to do, kind of thing, to keep them around, only that we start to recognize that we've had to travel down a path that we're losing some of the distinctiveness that makes them what they were, right, and that they're becoming something different. That's what we want to do. That's why it's a process, not just a simple, well, they disappeared and that's it. We'd like to bring to light that fact, right, so that people are aware of that. But again, if you have to make those choices and you have to apply those direct effects, by all means do so, right? Again, something is better than nothing. But that's kind of what we were trying to pull out of this is to what do we do in those situations? Like winter run chinook, right? We're going back and forth. They're almost completely hatching reliant in certain years. Other years we can, some spawn below the dam. But are those the same thing as just a natural run up in Alaska? Are we treating them the same way that just has low numbers? Maybe not so.
I can respond directly to the question too. That obviously chinook, coho, and steelhead are made up of multiple lineages in California, and different lineages had different probabilities of extinction. I think we could virtually always are going to have those species in California, and that's partly the decisions we have to make. Are we satisfied with just having representatives of those species like fall run chinook and a hatchery, or do we want to maintain their wild presence? That's why it's so important to talk about these indirect effects and try to maintain species in the wild with multiple species living together under wild circumstances. But all those, whether it's steelhead or coho or chinook, you have lineages that are on the verge of extinction. I would hate to choose between them, frankly.
So I have a comment that might turn into a question. Seems like people oftentimes don't go into doing these direct things, having a conservation hatchery, for example, or supplementing spawning substrate, thinking that it's going to go on forever. So can you comment on the potential for these actions to be temporary? And then would you list something as extinct under one of those six categories and then potentially extinct it later? I mean, I'm just looking at how there can be some policy problems here.
All right, so that was the hardest thing we came to when assessing, and that's why we kind of left it open. We were hoping to pull that out. Thank you. So that's kind of the thing. So is it an opinion thing, right? Can Peter and I stand up here and say, like, this is what you should do, this is what you shouldn't do in those situations? That was kind of the hardest point. So you can restore something, but you can never make it what it once was. It'll become something new, right? Because you've messed with it. Let's say you take it in and you artificially select for 20 years, 50 years. Does that change it? 50 or 100 years? Does that change it? 5 years. Does that change it? Right? That's a hard thing. In my opinion, it was that it reaches, it never gets past mitigated extinction. You always have to recognize that at one point we had to come in on its behalf and save it or it wouldn't exist at all. As soon as you had to apply direct effects to maintain it from going globally extinct, I think that it has reached that category that it can never go back to what it once was. You can still have something, but it will never be the same as what it was. It required direct effects for some length of time. So you've altered it, right? But where that line is, that's what I'm saying. That's very subjective. So I would totally, right? And I think that would be case by case. And that's why we suggested that the committee exists, that a group of biologists with differing interests so that no one interest was represented, just someone who's like, I think I'm a lumper, I'm a splitter, I think everything should have its place, stuff like that, to come together each time and assess where these things are and what level of extinction they've reached and say, like, no, we actually think that this is still essentially the same species in its natural habitat and that we had to do this very small effect. We don't think that this really matters, and then have to write that up and justify it to the rest of us as to why they made that decision. But I don't think any one person should do that in the same way that Peter and I can't stand up here and say, in every single case, you should do this or you should do that. I think that's too subjective to do that. So that's, again, that's the creation, that's those checkpoints in that committee that would come together from multiple interests that I think they would assess that in each individual case, which is a long-winded way of saying, I don't know. That's the hardest part. That's the hardest thing is this, right? All the rest of this, you can see, okay, it has general flow, you're fine, but what do you do? Like, for example, let's say nowadays, genetically, obviously, we can start bringing stuff back, right? All right, we're going to do Jurassic Park. So what is that? All right, so now you've got dino fish swimming around, and you release it into Crowley, right? So is that the same thing? Is that a species? Do we recognize it as such? And then the even harder question that when we originally were writing this up and thinking about it was for all freshwater fishes. But here in the United States, obviously, we have to abide by the Endangered Species Act. But if you're in Panama, it's just a straight decision. There's no necessarily a process that they have to follow. So they might want to go in and apply direct effects. Maybe they don't. The Endangered Species Act forces us to, whether we want to or not, that we have to on its, you know, protect it on its behalf. But what about in other countries where that doesn't apply? You don't have to do that, so maybe you just follow the left path. Maybe you just watch it drink out or blink out. Yeah. So.
How do you feel about the California condor program? Do you feel like it was a success where they took the chicks and raised them in captivity and then released them to the wild?
You can.
Well, the California condor program is, in many respects, is what we're talking about for Delta smelt. It's a situation where they trap the last individuals in the wild, which we're close to doing now with Delta smelt. You get them to breed in captivity, and then you release, finally, at some point, you release a bunch of the young into the wild and hope that they'll start reproducing, which some of them are doing. So, but on the other hand, they're still subject to lead poisoning, drinking antifreeze, and all these other things that are causing high mortality of the condors. And in fact, the most successful condor program is their introduction into the Grand Canyon, outside its quote unquote native range, although they were there prehistorically. So, these are the kind of things we might have to think about for Delta smelt. Do we, for instance, drain a reservoir and get rid of all the fish in it, and then plant Delta smelt in there? Or get rid of all the Wagasaki out of a reservoir and plant Delta smelt, or hybridize Delta smelt with Wagasaki. There are lots of things that we can do to maintain something that looks like a Delta smelt in the environment. The question is whether we want to do that or not, and where do you draw that line? As Jason said, that's where it becomes more of a societal or moral decision than it does a biological one.
So for winter-run Chinook salmon, Peter, you used the term mitigate extinction. I think probably that's a good concept for like scientists to use, accept. But in reality, maybe it's hard for some people to use the term extinction. What do you think?
Try that?
No, no, you want.
So the question, you know, is really all about using the word extinction when you still have the fish in front of you. That's really what we're saying, that there are times that the winter red Chinook salmon, we still have fish we're calling winter red Chinook salmon out there. How can you say they're give them some category of extinction? We're sort of doing that in part to be provocative, but the reality is, what do you mean by extinction? What do you mean when a species is extinct? The winter run is not out in the natural population much anymore, and even though it's migrating out to sea, it's not really doing much in the system. It's certainly not playing a role in the ecosystem to any great extent. It's entirely dependent on our maintaining its populations. If we defunded the winter run Chinook salmon program, the hatchery, the gravel replacement, even the water releases from Shasta Dam, we could do that, and the species would be gone in a couple of generations. So it's a species that is extinct except for the grace of humans. We're allowing it its existence to continue. And I think part of our idea is this: let's be honest about it, and say that's what's really going on here. And I hope that's you don't all agree with that.
I'd like to follow on about the mitigated extinction and the condor as an example. So, say you have something like the condor, obviously went through a severe genetic bottleneck. Its numbers are now increasing. Yet, I'd like a comment, and it seems, I don't know if anybody in this room would argue that it's as robust as it would have been a century or two ago. It seems like it's in peril for at least centuries of genetic drift to come.
That's a good question for you.
Don't you think it's worthwhile to continue to recognize it as such, that it is still imperiled and that it has reached that particular level, and that we did have to mitigate on its behalf? Not that we should stop doing it or stop protecting or stop recognizing it, only that it required us to directly get involved to continue its existence so there would be no California condor. That's all that mitigated extinction category does, is it gives us an idea of which lineages have existed or that we have currently that required us to directly involve ourselves. So let's say 100 years, 1,000 years from now, essentially that lineage wouldn't exist if it wasn't for humans stepping in on its behalf. That's kind of why we use the word mitigated, right? So again, still recognized, still the California condor, still as close to whatever California condor it can be, but it wouldn't exist without our help, which is very different from a conservation standpoint than something that's still a natural lineage in its natural environment doing its natural thing and trying to protect those, which is kind of the goal of conservation first, right? And that's kind of why we use this indirect versus direct effects. If you can eliminate the indirect effects that are causing a problem to usually the ecosystem, you're saving all the lineages within that ecosystem. But if you're allowing everything to drop into these extinction categories that we bring up, now you're lineage specific. Now every single lineage that falls in that category has to get individual work done it, individual biologists, individual funding, individual everything under the Endangered Species Act, at least here in the U.S. That seems like a much bigger problem if we allow it to drop all the way to there. And so my thing with Peter is, yes, we want to continue the word extinction because it does cause people to really perk their heads up and say, like, well, what's the goal? To prevent extinction, right? So we want to prevent ever having to reach those categories. I'd much rather we worked on the system and restored the system and saved every lineage in there than just worried until one dropped out and tried to save that one.
Let me say, with the California condor, this is a great example because it is so inbred, very limited genetic diversity. So if this is where we had to say, how far do we go? Right now it's sort of a flying museum specimen or something, the way they are. Should we engage in genetic engineering to increase the genetic diversity of condors so that they can withstand the changes, climate change, and so forth? We apparently have that capacity now. The Jurassic Park efforts, and there's, you know, next species we'll probably see an effort to restore is the passenger pigeon, using the band-tailed pigeon here in California as the major source of genes. So people think they can do this. So it gets into how much do we want to manipulate these species, and once we've manipulated them, what are they? Are they really a species or just a simulacrum of that species? If you're a bird watcher, do you really care if that condor has black vulture genes in its genome and it's not no longer pure, as long as there's a California condor flying overhead? Those are the kind of decisions we're facing.
I'll get to that question just a second. I just want to make one small point. What is it that defines a lineage as it is, right? Is it just its physical presence, right? It's all the things that make it up, right? It's the prezygotic barriers, the sexual selection, right? Which ones mate with which ones? Where do they live? Why do they live there? How do they fit into the ecosystem, right? And if we are artificially selecting, we're taking those things that would naturally be occurring in that system and we're removing them. For example, if we put a fish in a hatchery, right, we're removing prezygotic barriers, right? We put antibiotics in the water, we feed them, right? We put them all in one area, remove all predators through quarter of their life history. That's a major significant difference in what fish we're going to end up with versus what we started with. And I think we need to recognize that we've made changes by doing that. That's all we're trying to propose. Those are different.
As follow-up to that, and speaking as a birder, actually, I think we would care that there were black vulture genes in a condor because it does get to sort of what is a lineage. And from a sort of strictly phylogenetic standpoint, a lineage is sort of that set of genes. And if you're combining one lineage with another lineage in some way, sure, it affects both lineages. Maybe both of them cease to exist as independent, sort of unique entities.
They're an evolutionary trajectory, right?
Yeah.
And you've changed that directory into something else.
But just changing the trajectory does not make it cease to be a lineage. So if you take it into captivity, it's still, I would not apply the term extinction to it, like almost in any way, actually, because it's still very much existent. It's still very much extant.
So it's, as long as it looks like one, it's good?
Not even looks like one.
What makes it what it is? I guess that's kind of my question. What makes a lineage what it is? Is it just it's this series of genes? Because like we were using the pug example, right?
Yeah, and going to the pug example, I think you define it's hard to define a lineage as a set something because it's always changing. Every generation, wild or not, it's always changing. As such, I think the definition has to be sort of the limits. You know, does it breed with something else? Is it continuing on within its own sort of set boundaries? So, for example, a pug, if the gray wolf, you know, as we know it outside, died out completely. And in fact, if all other versions of the wolf and the dog all went extinct, all we were left with was the pug, I think the argument could be made that that species, that lineage, it's a small subset, but that lineage still definitely does exist. Canis lupus domesticus, does still exist.
I can't disagree with you, but I think one of the things we're also arguing for, a lineage does not really exist independent of its environment, that you really want, if you want the natural selection to continue operating on the species the way it has in the past, it has to be in an environment that contains most of the elements that the species was originally adapted for. Otherwise, we're playing God. Maybe that's fine. Maybe that's the role of humans in the upcoming century but we only do that with so many species. So it just becomes all the more imperative to try to save and protect natural habitats with as many of these species as possible. I think that's really one of our things we're trying to get across, that the job of trying to save so many of these lineages is really hard. It's much better if we can do it in sort of a collective basis and by protecting ecosystems and habitats. That's sort of obvious, but it's one of the things that we have to consider when you're working with all the species that are on the verge of disappearing.
Peter, is the delta as it exists today suitable habitat for the smelt?
Obviously not. The question was, is the delta today a suitable habitat for the smelt? No. There are some patches of habitat apparently up in the North Delta. You know, one of the wonderful things about all this research we've been doing is the fact that we do know that there are smelt that are spending their entire life cycle in fresh water. We shouldn't have been surprised with that because some of the old data indicates that, and indeed the captive breeding program suggests they don't need to get into brackish water or migrate. But of course, where, if you focus just on that small pieces of habitat that are up in the North Delta at the toe drain and some of these areas that are these resident populations can survive in, you're writing off a lot of the diversity of life history in the smelt. And we don't know if that can redevelop as system changes or not. It's also, though, again, it gets back to this idea of trying to protect, having indirect conservation, because the real, for Delta smelt, if we're going to really recreate habitat, the migratory habitat for Delta smelt, the best hope is to work with this arc of habitat that goes from the Yolo Bypass down through Cache-Lindsay Slough down the Sacramento River and into Suisun Marsh. If you really focus conservation efforts there, including outflows from the river, that's where you have the most greatest possibility of maintaining some kind of creating habitat for Delta smelt and other species or recreating it. And that means, of course, forgetting about the South and Central Delta, which to me are sort of a lost cause from the smelt point of view. So it's really, but right now, the Delta smelt are telling us the habitat is not there.
Yeah, I just wanted to bring up the point that, you know, we have this hatchery population that we've been maintaining, you know, with the hopes of, you know, it will be an appropriate source of fish to stock should we decide to supplement, augment, reintroduce, should they happen to go extinct in the wild. But there's the problem of water deliveries. So what happens if we put, okay, we've been thinking about this a lot in our lab. I'd like to make the point that it would probably be a lot easier to start doing these experiments, and I'm so glad that you brought that up, and I think that we really need to start doing that and think about reintroducing fish and supplementing them and or augmenting them, whatever word you want to use, before they go extinct in the wild. We're heading in that direction. It would just be a much easier task if we have fish in the wild still. The second is the point I had about water deliveries, and that there seems to be quite a bit of pushback about the idea of reintroducing smelt into the wild. And the reason, you know, it's interesting when I talk to people about this who are not involved in the Delta, they're like, well, why aren't they just putting the fish in the wild right now? And I'm like, oh, it's complicated. And it seems to be that the agencies don't know how to deliver water. If we're putting fish into the Delta, oh, all of a sudden, do we have a healthy population and we can just pump at will? So that's something that, you know, aside from the categories of extinction, and I know this is a more theoretical talk, but it's a real problem to have to deal with that. So I don't know if you guys can comment.
No, I agree with most of what you're saying. We have to line up. Oh, yeah. I don't have much to add to that because obviously these are complex issues that are we're all trying to think about and figure out what is the best thing, what's the best thing to do with the existing resources. So do you want to wind this up, or are we?
Well, it is one, so if anybody has to leave, feel free. But we have the room, so these guys already ate, so don't worry about them.
I will not be embarrassed if you leave.
But I think this conversation about management and water delivery is really interesting to a lot of people, so I think we should open up to discussion.
Maybe we should have another category of extinction, those species we let go extinct because we're afraid to do anything.
What would you call that? Species that are afraid to you'll go extinct because we're afraid. Yeah.
Politically extinct.
Politically extinct, yeah.
Where would you put that?
Self-mitigated?
So let's say that some of the Delta smelt habitat is restored through better freshwater flows, what have you, from Cache Slough down to Suisun Bay. How are they going to contend with all the invasive species we have now?
The question about invasive species of smelt is obviously a very real one. And that's partly we have to figure out how you deal with that issue. How do you increase productivity of those systems to provide the food supplies for Delta smelt? Obviously, that's a big issue. How do you control clams, the overbite clam? We don't know how to do this. I think there are things we could be doing, but they're expensive and they would be highly experimental. That's, again, one of the reasons perhaps you could argue let's just focus on those upstream freshwater populations because we can manipulate those systems for their productivity a lot better than we can the Suisun Bay, for example. I would like to just see these things discussed to see what are some of the options we can, big scale options for finding habitat for Delta smelt and trying to make some of these hard choices.
I'm just going to ask a quick follow-up question. Sorry, doing
way back in the room there.
What are the rules for if I wanted to go put smelt in right now, is that illegal?
You have to have a permit from the Fish and Wildlife Service, for sure.
Can someone answer that question? Would I get in trouble if I just took some of those smelt and took them with me on a boat and just put them out there?
Oh, yeah. The question was, I'm sorry, I don't know your name.
Nir.
If Nir just took some of Mandy's Delta smelt and took them on a boat ride and put them somewhere, would he be breaking the law? Yes.
I guess one of the things that I see in terms of, I guess if it would fall under mitigated extinction or one of those categories is not only when we're artificially manipulating the endangered or critically, I guess the mitigated extinction species, is when we're not only controlling predation in a captive facility, but when we're controlling what would otherwise be a natural predator. Such that, you know, we truck these fish around, we dump them out, and then we don't like the fact that the natural predators take advantage of that. Or, you know, we're getting rid of Caspian terns on the Columbia River because they have an island, you know, breeding on an island too close to where we're doing this. So I would think that would be another sort of boundary of that category of how do you address the fact we're not only changing that species, we're changing how we're managing a different species.
All right. One of the hardest things about this was we wanted to still make this relatively simplistic guidelines and categories, right? Which everyone's bringing up great points, and that's exactly what this idea is designed to do, right? To get us thinking about these things. But each individual case is going to be unique, and there's no way that we can stand up here and define every single one because it would be a 40-page document. There's actually some people who have attempted to try and define extinction like in every single case. And nobody wants to read it. It just got into some huge novel book. And so it's a simplistic idea, so at least we're starting to move forward on these ideas, to recognize these problems, to deal with them, right? As Peter said, to be honest about what they are and what we're dealing with, right? And I think that's the key to it, right? And then in certain situations, how far do we go and what do we do? I think that's going to be case-by-case basis. And I don't think any one or even a group of papers would be able to ever sum up all the possibilities of what we're facing. But we need to at least start dealing with it because it's a real thing and it's really coming and it's going to get worse. It's not going to get better. And so the sooner we start doing it, the better. And maybe these ideas start us on a path and maybe somebody comes up with a brilliant idea that no one's ever thought of. Right? I mean, that's the goal, right? Discussion.
So, yeah, I wanted to ask about this recently released Delta Smelt Resiliency Strategy. And do you think, how well do you think that's addressing those indirect effects? Is that along the lines of what you were thinking?
You're asking about how well does the releasing, if you did some experimental program releases of Delta smelt into the wild.
Delta smelt resiliency strategy, are you familiar with that? That the Natural
yes.
Resources Agency
yeah.
just released? Well, it seemed like you were saying step one, address the indirect effects, which I
yeah.
think is what that strategy is trying to do, and just wanted you to comment on that.
Well, we're so far into using the Delta smelt as a classic example of a fish species we're managing with direct effects, but it's still present in the wild. We still have a small population subject to natural selection. I think as long as we have that small population out there, we should continue to try to figure out how to work with it. And the reason I think that we could be able to use cultured population for experiments in the wild is the fact that genetic studies have been so good. Those fish are virtually identical to the wild fish. And I think that we could take a plot of a bunch of eggs, for example, and put them in cages out in the Yellow Bypass and and raise them up. So it gives us an opportunity to see if we can actually bring back some of that population at the right time. At the same time, obviously, as the Delta Smelt Resilience Strategy suggests, we need to be figuring out how we can manipulate the environment in ways that benefit the smelt. But, you know, there's so many complex issues here, but one of the problems we have is right now that we don't even know what will benefit smelt because there's so few out there, we can't see what kind of response they'll have to environmental change. So that's why I really pushed large-scale management of this North Delta Arc as sort of a way to approach things. And if the Delta Smelt goes extinct, it's probably going to be good for a lot of other species that are out there. And maybe we can bring back habitat to a point where we'll have a small window of time in which those cultured fish, it might be possible to use them for bringing back the Delta Smelt if it's gone extinct under present circumstances, assuming we bring back some habitat. And sort of a long-winded answer, but there's no easy answers.
I'm just curious, when a species is declared extinct, how long does it take for the policies that have been enacted to protect them to be deconstructed?
You want to answer that?
I think it's a 5-year, right? Well, we went back and forth. We never really got a straight answer on that.
Yeah, go ahead if you want to.
That's part of the problem. We never got a straight answer. There is no real, sometimes it's like, well, wait about 5 years, and okay, go ahead and do it. That's why Peter kind of made the joke that he just publishes it in his book and everybody goes, okay. Because that's kind of where we're at right now, and that's what this system that we're proposing at least starts to address and to get at some of those questions. And Peter set up some of the proposal that at the end there of his talk, right, get the governor, right, and they're dead and they're gone and we're, those kinds of ideas, but that's not actually in place right now. So nobody knows when to really stop, and you could probably stop today and make an argument for it or argue for 20 years from now. So it's – at least we never got a straight answer on it. Yeah. So
this is – it's all very complicated, and my brain is going all over the place, but so I'll try to keep it straight. I think I have two kinds of questions or comments about the – classification of being mitigated extinct. One thing would be that I think it's a good idea to keep an open mind about the ability of a species to, you know, thrive after a period of time and maybe a reevaluation of that species. I mean, if we're talking long term about this, and I think it goes with my other kind of concern, and that's with conservation measures and how, if something is classified under this category, what kind of impact is that going to have on us continuing to try to fix the habitat or, you know, create things that might actually allow the species that may have bottlenecked that we may have helped, we also get into the level of artificial selection too. So the condor program is actually very different from like the pug wolf, you know, scenario. So, but what we have, you know, because bottlenecking is happening all the time in the wild also. And so it doesn't mean that a species can't thrive after a bottleneck has occurred. And just because we helped it do that doesn't mean it's not the same species 100 years from now if it thrives in the future. So I just, those are some concerns, I guess.
Do you have an idea?
There's a lot to respond to there. I'm sort of drawing a blank. You want to go ahead? Yeah.
You're absolutely right. No, you're absolutely right. Those are some concerns, and where do you draw the line? And again, but the idea is to at least start thinking about that these things have changed. So if I guess in my mind, the first thing that jumps into mind is you say you have identical twins, right? And you raise them in two completely separate habitats, are they identical still? Right? Yes, on physical appearance, sir, but what makes them what they are is very different. And if we start changing everything that makes something what it was so that it becomes something else, it's not the same thing. That's kind of what we want people to realize. How many things are we going to change? How many natural selective pressures are we going to eliminate before it's no longer really what it was? It's something else, but it's not really what it was. And should we still continue to call it the same thing? that's kind of where we get into, right? How many changes can we make to it and still have it be the exact same thing that everybody recognizes as such? And those same policies that were enacted to protect it, right, are based on what it was, not what it has become. So you would have to start all over, because now we've introduced all kinds of new effects and evolution has gone in a different direction with because we've changed everything. So now we have to create conservation to deal with what it's become, not what it was. Yeah?
I think there's a lot to think about.
I
think
there's
a lot to think about, for sure.
You get diagnosed with cancer, you know, are you going, you know, you could go through chemo and get cured and then get hit by a bus 20 years later. I mean, it's just like we're making some assumptions in every choice that we make, you know, that was really morbid anyway.
I'm going to watch myself when I leave.
Sorry. What did you say? Yeah.
Sorry, get hit by a bus. But.
Anyway, I mean, yeah, we're never really going to know. We have to do everything we can do right now with the information that we have right now and the resources that we have right now. That's sort of how I feel.
Again, this gets back to this. I keep harping on it, how important it is to maintain the habitat, because the idea is we have sort of an ideal for each species. We have sort of an ideal in our minds of what that species is, which we sort of synthesized and, you know, in our brains about what this. But that is sort of a static perception. On the other hand, a species is constantly changing, even under totally natural conditions. It's always responding to environmental change. So we need to be able to maintain an environment that which natural selection is operating on these species, and that the environment itself is not so extreme that's going to the natural selection is going to eliminate the species. So again, it puts this on us that extinction is best prevented by trying to maintain environments within some limits that will keep the species from disappearing. Very hard to do, of course.
I have a question about the your recommendation for experimental outplanting delta smelt, and it's a bit of a follow-on to one of Mandy's comments. I agree with it, and I think that would be valuable. We'd learn a lot with experimental outplantings. But in cages, outplanted fish can't really do much for the wild population, right? So I'm wondering, outside of the political environment that we're in, would you recommend, for the sake of the species, that we actually start doing real outplantings where they have the opportunity to breed with wild individuals, or do you see drawbacks from doing that now?
Well, this is my own personal opinion here. I won't implicate Jason in any of this. That the delta, I think what I would like to see with delta smelt is an experimental outplanting with eggs, because I think that's the only life stage you can really embryos are, that you can really use to have any hope of reintroducing them in the wild. You put them in a cage, you put them on, you get these smelt in the hatchery to spawn on platforms or mats like they do in Japan. They have similar species they manipulate all the time. You break those mats out in the wild, but in a cage, to mainly to exclude predators, egg predators like inland silversides and so forth. You put them in a food-rich environment. You let these fish hatch, raise them up to a point where they're, oh, who knows what the optimal size would be, a few millimeters long, and then at that point take away the cage, and ideally they'd be in a situation like the tow drain or Liberty Island or someplace where they'd have a good natural habitat. That's sort of the vision I have of the way to do it. But my idea is right away to start supplementing that population, because we can, the genetics are so good. And we can you can identify those fish from the cultured populations. They don't even need to be tagged or anything. You can use genetic identification to see if they're really making it or not, or if they're contributing to the wild population. Again, that's not what everybody thinks, of course.
Right here. I'm going to change gears and go back to our anadromous salmonids, if that's okay.
Sure.
Wouldn't you agree that 100% mark out of our hatcheries with CWTs would be the way to go for planning for the future here?
Well, I've certainly said that before, yes.
And do you foresee this extinction committee driving things such as funding for that? Because it's a financial problem for the state to mark 100% of our fish.
So, you should say, well, I guess it could, because it would be one way, if you're marking all these fish, and one way to distinguish winter run and spring run from fall run in the fishery, for example. The interesting thing is our genetic techniques are getting so good now that some of that distinguishing, you don't necessarily need to have marked fish. I think we're in a new era where the ability to identify individual fish is getting to be so good that maybe we can get away from the need for individual marks. I still like that idea because I'd like to know, for example, what are those fish going up Pewter Creek? Where do they come from? And not have to be able to tell from a tag or something. But I think this could drive this kind of management of the fish. Yes, let's try to separate the wild from the hatchery fish from the, or the endangered fish from the non-endangered ones.
So if I could quickly follow up, do you have a plan to implement some sort of committee, extinction committee?
Go ahead, Jason.
We're actually, so Peter and I have been kicking around these ideas for about 3 months now, right, trying to deal with issues and questions, and that's kind of why we set up this talk, is we want feedback. We want to know, is this a good idea, is this not a good idea, right? Is everybody just like, no, presence, absence, that's it. Why even spend the time? So there is no perfect answer, but we're trying to put together something that's at least a reasonable start that will hopefully grow from here. And so whether or not it gets to every anadromous issue, I don't know. I mean, I still think that over time, spending now versus having to spend for the rest of time because of the Endangered Species Act says we have to, right? I don't know if those costs, you know, how you weigh costs in terms of maybe it's big now, but it's small compared to a 50-year program and all the people you have to hire and the biologists you have to go out. But as far as the committee goes, that's something that we're still trying to figure out who's best to sit on that particular committee. I think it should be a mixture of both agency and academics. Right, which is not always the easiest, but that's kind of what you want there, right? You want differing opinions, right? I think you need multiple people to sit on that, but I think it would need to happen yearly if we're really going to get at some of these hard questions and really get people who are in the know about that particular lineage and what's best for it, right? But
yeah, this committee is a pie in the sky idea we have, frankly.
Yeah.
But it's to get people to think about, we need to be ready to have a mechanism for declaring species extinct. We are going to see extinction. If it's not the Delta smelt, it's some insect, a bird. There's all kinds of other organisms out there besides fish that are in danger of extinction. So we need to be thinking about how do you actually determine whether or not a species is extinct and who makes that decision. Because obviously you can make a, doesn't matter whether it's an insect or a fish, it can have a big impact on how you manage the landscape or the waterways. And so we need to determine that.
There's a question in the back now. Yeah.
Hi. So I have a comment about, you know, lineages are difficult to define. And, you know, one thing that might be useful is, you know, what is that species' contribution to the ecosystem as a whole? And what is their role in that ecosystem? And if we do lose them, does that mean that that role is no longer existing in that ecosystem? Maybe that could be a criteria for extinction.
That's for me, again, this is my personal opinion, that's really hard because now you're opening up another can of worms that it gets really subjective as to what contribution does a species have, right? Is it its presence? Is it its absence? Does it have to contribute? Is it keystone species? Is it all that foundational species? That's even harder to define. And so, as you can see, we start out with a simple point, right? And we keep adding things. Okay, so what's a lineage, right? People are arguing, what's a species, right? What's, you know, do we, at the general level, where do we define these lines? Where do we start to do this? Because it's all subjective. Nature didn't design this. It's all us kind of figuring out what we like as a group. So, I understand your question. I don't know if we could define that in trying to assess extinction.
But do you think that's harder than defining a lineage, for example?
Well, the lineage idea was just because it's so controversial just trying to figure out what a distinct entity is, because that's subjective, right? Genetically, right, we can define everything nowadays. We have so much power that we can group things virtually any way we want, right, depending upon what level you want to scrutinize it at. So when do we get to these lines?
the species that almost all the species we have recognized are based on morphological changes, morphological differences, right? That's the majority of species out there are like that. And now there's genetics going through which are assessing that, but there's still no real defined line as to what is a species. There's paper after paper. Everybody every year comes up with a new way to define a species, right? And then we try to get around that by, let's just call it a management unit, right? So let's just manage that group over there because they're important to us, or we like them, or we're going to define, we're going to draw a circle around it, and that looks cool. That's, I don't know how you would start that. And if it, you agree with it, or let's say the room agrees with it, but does everybody agree with it? And, you know, then you end up like our extinction idea. Some people like it, some people don't like it. Does it turn into management policy? Does anybody do it? Let's say we publish a paper, but if nobody takes it to heart or anybody uses it, it's, we're in the exact same place we were before, right, which is what we have now, which is ambiguity. So
I was just going to say one of the projects Jason would love to embark on is to find the genetic ways to do, how do you define a species, and he has some ways to do that. So if anybody has any spare change, let us know.
So let's just take a couple more questions before we wrap it up. I saw there, and then we'll go back there afterwards.
Yeah, I had a question for Jason.
Oh, sure.
It's one of your slides in your talk, and it was a slide. It had a picture of a dam, and then the rock slide.
Yeah.
And you equated the two together.
Well, yeah, it's an indirect effect. Putting in a dam influences, right? We can put in a dam, but sometimes dams are created naturally. So I wasn't going to say that just by a direct effect would not be putting in a dam per se, right?
Okay.
Because you're not lineage. It's not lineage specific, right? It has a natural occurrence, so it would be indirect effect.
But what about an area where there couldn't be a rock slide, but there is a dam that exists there?
See, again, I would argue that's not still lineage specific, which is where we're trying to go with the idea of extinction. I agree that the indirect direct is not a perfect line, but the goal with that was to make the extinction process work towards focusing on those indirect effects to fix system-wide problems as opposed to getting into these every lineage question problems and focusing on those ideas, right? To getting to it before it gets to individuality. So, but again, there, I think you can go back and forth with that. And, but the idea of the dams was that there was a natural component to that. And a lot of the stuff that we do, there are natural occurrences that do happen to that, right? Temperature changes, water flows, invasive species, that's all natural processes. Even if, you know, how something gets from the East Coast to the West Coast, probably not, right? But there is invasives that get moved around. That's how we have things where are where they are. So time is a component to that as well. So I don't have a great answer for you on that one per se.
Hi. So it seems like we've talked about using the Delta smelt that we've cultured as eventually starting to experiment and put those out into the wild in some fashion. And I agree with you that we have a really well established process in which we rear Delta smelt for that. My only concern, and I want your comments on it, is where we put our efforts and why. And the reason I say this is we've been pumping out salmon for over 100 years, and I'm hoping we learn some lessons from some of that. And one of my concerns would be for Delta smelt is that we're not looking or putting our efforts toward the real mechanisms causing the decline of Delta smelt. And I'm worried that, and I want your comments on, do you think that actually mitigating in some way or starting to put smelt out there could hasten smelt getting into that extinction process even more by becoming reliant on that mitigation itself? And I hope that makes sense what I'm saying.
No, obviously you're putting your finger on an important issue, which is, but the problem we've gotten into with salmon. Where we have salmon populations that are totally reliant on hatcheries, and the hatcheries in turn have exerted selection pressure that makes it so it's very difficult for us to get away from hatcheries. I would hope with Delta smelt we would have learned something that we could start working with populations and that they could truly intersect with the wild populations, which is why there's a sense of urgency to this, because if we are unable to bring those Delta smelt from the wild to keep breeding, interbreeding with that cultured population, that population, no matter how hard we try, is going to become increasingly domesticated. So I think we have a fairly narrow window of time to do that. And the goal should be to see if you can enhance the wild population, and perhaps you could argue, well, we'll be selecting for fish that are resident smelt rather than migratory smelt. That might be a kind of choice we'd want to make. I'm making the assumption if we really want to have smelt around. You know, if they disappeared tomorrow, it would make no difference to the ecosystem, so it really becomes a choice for us. Do we want this wonderful little species to stay with us, or are we willing to sacrifice it? Certainly anything we do with those cultured smelt to try to enhance the wild population is a desperation effort. It's the only thing it can be called.
Thank you.
So before we wrap up, unless anybody has, I saw your hand was up for a while, so we'll do one last question there. As I'm walking over there, I just want to ask if, does anybody here and who's brave wants to raise their hand, think that we should just keep it as it is now, or is there kind of a general consensus that we need a new way to detect extinction? You could just think about that and we could talk about it at the very end.
So what I'm wondering about, there's a lot of things, but I'm kind of concerned that with all those different categories that it could mean more arguing about where it belongs and what happens, what policies would be in place for each category. Also, I'm not a biologist, so I'm wondering, even if, like with salmon or what we're doing with the smelt and all the other species, even if they aren't exactly what they were when they were wild and there were a lot of them, is it still valuable to have those genes around?
I got that. See, now we're talking about devil's hole pupfish. Perfect example of that, right? Are you familiar with devil's hole pupfish? There's about 30 of them right now, and they're isolated in a small pool in the middle of Nevada, well, not in the middle, on the end of Nevada, right? And it's 95 degrees Fahrenheit that they live in, and they have virtually no oxygen. But it turns out that they've lived there for thousands and thousands of years, completely isolated. And the populations have gone from a couple hundred to up to 1,000, and lately they've been down around 30, right? So they've U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service just bought a $3 million facility that mimics the light that the hole gets. They basically made the hole in a building so that the roof opens and the temperatures and the pumps and the salt and everything, they recreate the conditions exactly. And they've got a captive population that they've made from those. And so they're like, at what point do we bring those in? They're very much like the Delta smelt. Do we bring them in? Do we not? And so the arguments against that has been, well, they've been in there for thousands and thousands of years, and likely they've done this their whole time. But those genes are unique, and so many have argued that they're an evolutionary novelty unto themselves. How have they been able to do that, right? Everything else we see, if you get on that trajectory, it's crash and it's over, right? So that into itself, it makes them interesting. So, right, I think Delta smelt represent a bit of, we've reached a similar kind of thing, right? They've been narrowed down to this bottleneck, and we have great genetic data on them, but they've become a way to propose what's going to happen with the next species or the next species after that. Do we reach a certain point? Can we project what we're doing? And so Peter and I have been reading some literature on there's actual probability theory now in extinction projection. That based on the information that they have, they can project how long before the species goes globally extinct, as we put it. So that's an even different direction that they're trying to go with this idea of extinction. And so you're absolutely right. Even the 7 or 8 categories we put up there can get meddlesome. But even the comments here, I think we already moved up to 12 categories if we try to deal with that. Or we could even move into this projection idea, right, which is mathematical on how long. So Delta smelt, I don't know what the number is. I don't think anybody's done that. But
13,500.
That's how long until they're gone, or that's how many are left?
That's how many are left.
So there's 13,500. And so if we were to apply these mathematical principles, it might give us an idea how long they'll survive if they were left to what they were. Does that mean we wait? Or does that mean we go now? I don't know. Those are good questions. That's hard to define.
Okay, let's wrap it up. Let's thank our speakers. Thank you, everyone.
Any ideas, feel free to email me.